for. Come before his presence with thanksgiving. And we're gonna enter into his courts with praise and be thankful unto him. And be thankful unto him, for he is worthy. Worthy of all praise. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. And his mercy is everlasting. And his truth enduring forever. And be thankful unto him. And be thankful unto him. For he is worthy, worthy of our praise, for he is worthy.
Give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Father in heaven, we thank you again for the blessing of being able to be in your presence and to worship you and to give you praise and honor and glory. Lord, we're here and we're excited to be with you. We just ask, Lord, that you would give us the blessing that you have prepared for us collectively and individually as we give you the honor, praise, and glory that's due you and you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing for our opening hymn. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, Marching to Zion. It will be on the screen, and it is also found in your hymn books, number 422, Marching to Zion. We're going to sing all four verses out together as a church family. Amen? Amen. Come we.
Come we that love the Lord and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus surround the throne. And thus surround the throne. We're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion. That beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of the heavenly King, the children of the heavenly King will speak their joys abroad. They speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion.
The hill of Zion.
The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly fields, or walk the golden streets, or walk the golden streets,
we're marching
to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion, that beautiful city of God.
You all sound great. This next one, let's bring it out. Then let our songs.
Then let our songs abound, and every tear be dry. We're marching through.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. This is the portion in our service where we take time to welcome those who are visiting with us. This morning we have Quentin Daniels, Brianna Taylor, and Brandon Prim. We also have Peterson Warren here with us. And we want to welcome every one of you. I want to welcome each and every one who's here in our church today. Dominique and Ramon Rade, Charles and Judith Hahn as well. We are so pleased that you have chosen to worship with us here at City Temple. It is such a pleasure to have you here in our house today. I pray that the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit fall afresh on each and every one of us. So, church, at this time, let's welcome those who are visiting with us. Let's welcome each other. Happy Sabbath.
Won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Won't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. You tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name.
Everybody smile. Everybody smile.
Jesus loves you.
Amen. Isn't it good to know today that Jesus loves you? Amen. It's so good to see all of your happy, smiling, bright, and beautiful faces. Word of God says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad to be in God's house today. What do you say? Amen. I just want to share just a couple of announcements with you today. I also want to welcome you. It's so good to have you in service today. I also want to welcome our students and teachers from Peterson. The announcements that I'd like to share, amen. Amen. Praise God. The announcements that I'd like to share with us today are that, first of all, we want to praise God for his blessing to some among us who have been ill, some in the hospital, seriously ill, who are now recovering. Amen? Amen. That is a blessing. The Lord has answered our prayers. First of all, we're so happy to see Sister Stella Young in worship today. We were praying for her just last week. Welcome back, Sister Young. Also, we want to continue to pray for Elder Samuel Flagg. Pastor Flagg has been ill for a few weeks now, but we praise God that his condition is improving. And so that is an answer to prayer. Also, Sister Gloria Fennison was seriously ill, but is now also, she has recovered. And we praise God for that. Isn't that a blessing? Amen. Those are always wonderful things to hear, the answers of the Lord to the prayers that we send up. We want to give him glory for that. We continue to pray for the Porter family. We know that, unfortunately, recently we lost Deacon Burgess Porter. His funeral is going to be here at City Temple this Monday. The family hour is going to be at 12, and the funeral service will be at 1. We want to invite you to attend. Also, there's going to be a visitation at the funeral home, Wilson Akins, the Northwest Chapel, 17500 Finkel. This information is in your bulletin, so you'll be able to refer to it. And then there's information there also for the repast that will take place right after the service, which will be at East Point Manor on Gratiot, 24611 Gratiot. The information is there. We want to invite you to look at it. We continue to pray for the Porter family. Also, we want you to remember, we sent out an announcement last night that all women are being called. Women's Ministry is calling all women for a brief time of prayer and praise. It's going to be right after service today. All women, we're inviting you just to gather down front, and we're going to hear from our women's ministry leader at that time. So please bear that in mind. Then finally, we want to remind us that today is the first day of our week-long spring revival. A week-long spring revival. Amen. I heard somebody say amen. Amen. All week long, we're going to be focusing on how to live a spirit-filled life every day. That's what we're going to be learning from the Word of God. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be a life-changing time together. We're going to meet this morning and then again tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. here at the church. Sunday night, Monday night, then on Wednesday night, we're going to join with our sister church who's having their meetings, Conant Gardens. We're going to join with Conant Gardens on Wednesday night, and then we'll come back here on Friday night and then end on Sabbath morning. All week long, we're going to be talking about the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, and how to be filled with the Spirit. We're also going to be taking time to explain some common misunderstandings about the ministry of the Holy Spirit that has led many Christians astray. We want to know exactly what it means to be filled with God's Spirit and exactly what it looks like once you are, not only individually, but for a church family. And you do not want to miss it. As a matter of fact, I want to invite you to plan to be here. But then also, I want you to be thinking, ask the Lord to show you who you can invite to come. So you can invite several people, family members and friends and co-workers and neighbors, people who you know that love God, you want to invite them to come. People you know who need God, you want to invite them to come. Anyone you can think of, because they will be blessed by this time of revival together. We want to invite you also to be praying, not only for our church, but all of the churches in the Lake Region Conference.
which will be going through this time of spiritual revival together in this season. We want to pray that the Lord will pour out his spirit on our churches and that we'd be transformed and used by him as witnesses to lift up the name of Jesus in the world. What do you say, everyone? May the Lord continue to bless us this morning as we worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, before we move on and we ask Peterson to come to give their first presentation to us, I want to ask our church clerk if she would come, Sister Aretha Petaway. She has a few second readings of transfer of membership.
Good morning, church. This is the second reading for transfers of membership. Jeremy Grant from Ottawa Adventist Church in Ottawa, Ontario to City Temple. Frederica St. Clair Grant from Shechem SDA Church in Arlington, Massachusetts to City Temple. Roy Miller from Johnsontown SDA Church in Kingston, Jamaica to City Temple. Enid Penny from Toronto Perth Adventist Church in Etobicoke, Ontario to City Temple.
Now somebody else say amen. We praise God. Those are quite a few membership transfers into City Temple, and we praise God for that. What is your pleasure at this time, church? It's moved with support. All in favor, let it be known by saying aye. Opposed by the same sign, it is carried, and we praise God for that. We would like to also make you aware that the family of Elder Flagg has requested that as he recovers, that we have no visitors at this time. So please let us pray for Elder Flagg, but let us not visit at this time. God bless you. We want to invite Peterson to come. And we want to welcome our interim president, principal, Lynette Jefferson.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, church family. Isn't it wonderful that every Sabbath morning, doesn't matter where you are in the world, if you're at church, you can say good morning, family. I'm so happy to be here, and as the students come forward, as the staff bring the students forward, I just want to thank you for having us this morning. We wanted to praise with you, praise our God, who is very merciful, who has been with us at the school. No matter what the devil throws at us, God is greater, and we can count on him, and we are so thankful. And so they need to come quickly. Keep going. Keep going.
Amen.
So the order that we're going to do, we have a few presentations. We're going to have a presentation from one of the students who has something she'd like to share with you. Then some of our high school students will be making a Spanish presentation. Our elementary will be doing a poem about Ellen White's first vision. And then the students will be singing a song. And then Miss Elder Roberta Perry, every Friday we have chapel. And in chapel, we've been learning the fundamental beliefs of the church. And we're going to demonstrate what they've been learning in chapel.
Good morning, church. My name is Janaya Kirby, and I attend Peterson Warren Academy. So if you didn't know, I'm a 10th grader, and I've been attending Peterson since the third grade. So I've been hearing about the concerns that people have had about Peterson and what they don't like and what we don't have, but I'm grateful to be at Peterson because we do have a spiritual aspect. And I have people that I love at Peterson. Without Peterson, I probably wouldn't be as close with God as I am now, and I wouldn't have the friends that I do now. So if you didn't know, my brother is Miles Robertson, and he's been diagnosed with cancer, and he's had it for 6 years now. So we've been going through our little trials and tribulations with our family, and what I can say is that Peterson has been constantly praying for him and my family, and they've been helping out. And the reason why I wanted to stay at K-12 is because I don't know where I would be without Peterson. It's really changed my life for the better, and without them, I don't know, I probably wouldn't just be myself. But I'm close to graduating also, and I just haven't been able to experience public school, like, ever, except for, like, first and second grade, but that's nothing. But I just want to stay where I am because it's comfortable for me, and I love God, and I'm thankful that we do have that aspect there. The teachers are very well taught, and they know what they're talking about. And even though we might not be the best students, they put up with us, and they're really good at what they do. And I just want to say I love you guys, and yeah.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Feliz Sabado. Sabbat felicit. And my name is Ms. Fulcher. I am the Spanish teacher and the English teacher, and those are my lovely students. And since next week, it's Easter, they're going to say something in Spanish about Easter. So what happened to the Easter is the crucifixion of Jesus Christ and the resurrection. So that's what they're going to say in Spanish. I know some of you may not understand, but just bear with us and just think of God's sacrifice for all of us. Because he didn't die only for me or for them. He died for all of us so we can have everlasting life. So please bear with them and bear with me, and let's have a good Sabbath. Amen.
Cuando Jesús murió, la cortina en el templo se rompió. Se rompió de arriba para abajo. Esta cortina dividía dos cuartos. Un cuarto era solo para el sacerdote mayor y él para los otros sacerdotes. Cuando Jesús murió, es él hizo posible de que todos puedan ir y pedir a Dios. Jesús es ahora nuestro sacerdote mayor.
And I will say the part for somebody else who's not here. It says, aún estado en la cruz, las personas lo conocían como el Hijo de Dios. Uno de ellos era un ladrón que estaba siendo crucificado en otra cruz al lado de Jesús. Otra persona fue soldado romano. El soldado sintió un sismo mientras miraba a Jesús y empezó a tener miedo y dijo, él sí era el Hijo de Dios.
Regreso a la vida.
The resurrection.
Un hombre llamado José fue a ver a Pilates, el gobernante, y le pidió el cuerpo de Jesús. José era un hombre rico y era uno de los discípulos de Jesús. Él bajó el cuerpo de Jesús y lo envolvió en una tela y lo puso en su propia tumba. Pilates ordenó a algunos soldados que vieran el cuerpo de Jesús. Él temía que los discípulos de él se lo iban a robar y después decir que él revivió.
Okay, Un domingo por la mañana, unas mujeres fueron a la tumba. Ellas trajeron unas especias que habían preparado para poner en el cuerpo de Jesús. Hubo un gran sismo, y de momento vino un ángel y rodó la piedra grande que había al frente de la tumba de Jesús, y se sentó en ella. El ángel le dijo a las mujeres, «No tenga miedo, Jesús no está aquí. Él ha regresado como lo prometió. Miran, Él no está aquí». El ángel le dijo que se lo digan a los discípulos. Mientras ellas se iban, Jesús las encontró. Jesús les dijo, dígale a mis hermanos que vayan a Galilea y me van a ver allí. Los hermanos fueron y comieron con él.
Los hombres caminaban hacia el pueblo de Emaús. Jesús caminó y habló con ellos. Luego, cuando todos estaban listos para comer, Jesús dio las gracias y picó el pan. Lo reconocieron inmediatamente. Todos estaban felices. Jesús estaba vivo.
Muchas gracias. Thank you.
Is the wise friend's vision.
Thank you. Lord, let your light up your face, shine on us. Lord, let your light up your face, shine on us, that we may be saved, that we may have life to find our way in the darkest night. Let your light shine on us. Let your light shine on us.
Sabbath, everyone. Okay, is it Peterson? I need you to look at me. Shall I come down there? Are you gonna look at me? All right, wonderful. My name is Roberta, and I open the Word of God to Peterson every Friday at chapel. I want to just say I love my Peterson Warren Academy students. Amen. They are smart as a whip. So, just for a brief minute. First, there's just some things that they're learning in chapel. They're learning the 28 fundamental beliefs. They're learning how to be saved, and they're learning prophecy. So what you're going to do, you're going to join us in chapel for about a few seconds, and we're going to go over just a few things that we've been learning about prophecy, Daniel 2 and Daniel 7. Are you ready?
Amen.
Ready?
Ready.
Nice and loud? Okay, I need you to come up here so I can see you. Yeah, I need to see you.
just right here. You can stay right there, as long as I see you. Because he's short, I couldn't see. Okay, all right, are you ready? Okay, so this is just a brief synopsis about prophecy, what they've been learning. So we're going to go with Daniel 2 and Daniel 7. Nebuchadnezzar's statue, are you ready? Okay, what is the head made of? The kingdom. The ruler. The beast that goes with it. What does the lion have on his back? And what does the wings represent? All right, chest and arms. Good, you're doing good. You're warming up. Here we go. Chest and arms. What is it made of? What is it?
Silver.
The kingdom. The rulers. And the beast that goes with it. And what does the bear have in its mouth? And what does that mean? Three kingdoms that is conquered. Can you name them? Wonderful, wonderful. Let's go down to the belly and thighs. What is it made of? And who's the ruler? The kingdom. Can you make sure they can hear you? So what's the kingdom? And the beast that goes with it. The beast that goes with it. How many heads does a leopard have? And what's on the leopard's back? How many wings? What does that represent? Now let's go back to the heads. How many heads? And now we know that we studied that those are the generals that took over when Alexander the Great died. Can you name them? Go. Wonderful. Let's go to the legs. And what are the legs made of? And the ruler. And the kingdom. Rome. Very good. Can we go to the feet? Okay, let's go down to the feet. What is the feet made of? Why? Because what? They'll never be united as one. Wonderful. Let's go to the toes. How many toes? Toes represent what? Aha, so they had 10 kingdoms, but three of those were destroyed. Can you name the ones that were destroyed? Wonderful, that leaves seven left that's still standing today in Western Europe. Can you name all seven? Go.
Portugal, Italy, Germany, Spain, England, France.
Wonderful, and tell me about that rock. What does that rock do? To take us to heaven, and when we get there, you know the streets are made of, and the gates are made of, and the walls are made of. How long will we live there? How will we get there? And for how about how long? All right, now tell me something. Name that tree that's in the middle of the city. Huh? Say it. And how many trunks? What are trunks made of? And what's the name of that city? And what's the shape of that city? And if you want to go, you need to say amen with me.
Amen.
Amen. There you go.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Let's give the kids of Peterson a hand clap of praise. They are truly the future. Let's do better than that. Let's celebrate them this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just want to sing a couple songs and get out of your way. How many know that we serve a great God?
Amen.
That we serve a God that's mighty, that's strong. And we just give him praise this morning because he is great.
Amen.
Come on, let's put our hands together and celebrate a great God. Hallelujah. Come on, turn it up, turn it up, turn it up. Go.
worship one more time. See ya. Is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God. Come on, somebody, you put your hands together just like this. You just came to praise the Lord this morning and give him all the glory that he's due this morning. We're going to sing that together, everybody. See how great.
How great
is our God,
is our God.
Sing with me.
Sing with me. How great
is our God,
is our God.
All will see.
All will see.
How great is our God.
Is our God.
So right, if you clap your hands and give God the glory, he deserves all the praise. We're going to do a little call and response. It goes like this. It says, I lift my hands,
I lift my hands
to give you glory.
To give you glory.
And I lift my hands,
I lift my hands
to give you praise.
To give you praise.
And I praise you, Lord.
I'll praise you, Lord.
And I'll praise you, Lord.
I'll praise you, Lord.
Will you praise? Yeah.
Testimony that
I'll praise you, Lord.
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 And I'll praise you, Lord.
Come on now, somebody, if you make that declaration, begin to put your hands together and give the Lord a praise. By making that declaration, you just declare that no matter what you're going through, no matter what circumstances you are faced with, that you will give God praise. You will give God praise in the good times, in the adverse times, in the struggle. When it's time to celebrate, I will praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we want to make another declaration this morning to say that, Lord, you are good. We can't praise you enough, God, for everything that you've done, God. We owe you our lives, Father. And we just came here this morning just to say that you've been good. Can anybody agree with that this morning? Hallelujah.
All right, let's celebrate the King. Come on, one more time, put your hands together and give the Lord a real praise.
It's now time for our offering.
Happy Sabbath, church.
Happy Sabbath.
It is now time for us to put our money where our heart is. It's time for our tithe and offering. Shall we obey God and bring in all our tithe and offerings, that there may be meat to supply the demands of souls that are hungering for the bread of life? God invites you to prove him now. He pledges his word, "I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. Neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, says the Lord of hosts." Thus his word is our assurance that he will so bless us that we shall have still larger tithes and offerings to bestow. "Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts." Will the deacons come forth to receive our tithe and offerings? Loving Father, we have come to worship you through our tithe and offering. We first of all thank you for what you have given us, for we realize that everything that we have comes from you. So we ask that you would bless our tithe and our offering, and bless us, Lord, as we receive our tithe and offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. As we take up our offering, we're going to sing, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good." How many of you know he's good? I got about maybe 5 people over here. 10. How many of you know he's good? Amen. All right. Sing with us, church. "Oh, give thanks." Said, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy, for he is good, yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good, yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he said. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good, yes, for he is worthy. Worthy, worthy, for he is good, yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he said. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good, yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good, yes, he is good. One more time. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he said. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy, for he is good, yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy, for he is good, yes, he, for he is good, for he is good, yes, he is good, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Amen. Amen.
there's some people that we need to remember in prayer. We were asked to pray for Sister Slayton's daughter, Ivani. She has some health concerns. Remember Elder Flagg, as the pastor just said. Remember the Porter family. We're going to funeralize him on this Monday. And Sister Gloria Fennison, and a prayer of praise for Sister Stella being back with us today.
Amen.
Also, we need to keep in mind our principal of Peterson Warren, Sister Jefferson.
Amen. Amen.
I don't know, many of you don't know, but she is a hard-working lady.
Amen.
And to be the administrator, she doesn't have any problem doing whatever it takes to move our school forward. And we just want to let you know we appreciate you, Sister Jefferson. And you are in our prayers along with your staff members and your teachers and everyone that's out there working to try to make our school the place it needs to be. I was sitting there thinking when I saw the Peterson Warren people come up, all the kids. I remember when I was at Peterson. Yes, I did go to Peterson. It was a long time ago. And when Peterson opened up, I was in the third grade. That was a long time ago, but it's good to know that they're still operating and we're still trying to keep Christian education alive in the Motor City area. You know, we don't know when our time is going to be up, do we? And so as Christians, we know that Jesus' coming is soon. Amen. And if you don't believe that, then you haven't read your Bible lately. But every time we go through life, sometimes the cares and concerns of life get us so caught up that we forget that Jesus is coming soon. I got word this week that one of my cousins passed. One of the cousins that I graduated from Oakwood Academy down in Oakwood, Alabama, passed this week. I don't know if many of you know him, Lewis Humphrey. And it sort of struck me because we're the same age. And I'm sitting there thinking, time is not promised to anybody. Your next moment is not promised to you. So it's necessary as Christians and people who believe that Jesus is real and he's exciting that we need to constantly pray. 2 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. If I can't talk to you, if I can't see you, the one thing that I can do for you is pray for you. And as Christians, we ought to be praying for everything and everybody all the time. In fact, we need to have an inch and a half of callus on our knees from just being down there praying all the time. But God is good, isn't he? And he hears our prayers when we get down on our knees and genuinely ask him for help and assistance in this world full of sin. He will help us, won't he? So as we pray this morning, let's just keep in mind that Jesus is coming soon and that we need to talk to him more. And we need to let him talk to us all the time because that's the only way that we can make it. Right in your seats right now, if you're near someone, reach out and just touch them. You don't have to get up. Stay right there. Just reach out and touch that person. Hold their hand while we're praying together. If you got to reach around, if you're in the seat by yourself, reach around and touch somebody. Reach around and do that. Just right where you are. We want you to just touch somebody. Father in heaven, we thank you again for being a God who cares for us and who loves us and who wants us to be with him throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity. A God who sees our struggles, who sees our pain, who sees our agonies and our frustrations from moment to moment, and you care about us and you love us always. Lord, you said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. And we claim that promise today in Jesus' name. Lord, we've got so many concerns and so many things that are on our mind. And sometimes, Lord, we can't even sit in church without worrying and being concerned about things that are on our mind. But Lord, we ask now that we would give you those burdens and that you would lift those burdens from us, those cares, those worries, so that we can worship you in the spirit of holiness. Lord, we know you're coming soon. And what we want, Lord, is we want to be ready. We want to have that relationship with you that goes beyond a casual prayer or a casual reading of the word. We want to pray all the time and stay in an atmosphere of prayer. We want to get into your word daily and read your love letters to us so that we understand how much you care and want us to be with you. And then, Lord, as something exciting always happens in our life, we can't keep it to ourselves. Help us to go out and witness and share our faith and let people know that Jesus is real and he's exciting and he's coming back to take us home soon. So we need to get ready. There's so many things in this world, Lord, that frustrate us. And we know the enemy's out there and he's drawn targets on each one of us who have already given our allegiance to Jesus. And he's constantly shooting at us. But Lord, he is a defeated foe. You have won the victory over him. And he can't bother us unless we let him. Lord, we are excited about being at church. A time when we can lift you up in song and in scripture and through the spoken word. And we ask today, Lord, that you would give our pastor, Pastor Duncombe, a double portion of your spirit, and that you would enclose him with your spirit so the words that he speaks and the messages and the principles that he relays, we will be able to see Jesus clearly, and we will be able to understand, and we can accept him today, now, as our Lord and our Savior. Bless him, Lord, as he gives us what you have given him. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. And we praise you and we lift your name up on high today, realizing that there's only one way we can be saved. My Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And that name is the name that's above every other name, and that name is the name of Jesus. And so, Lord, we call on Jesus all the time. And we call his name because he's worthy to be praised. Now, Lord, as we worship you in spirit and truth, be in our worship, be in our praise, be in our thanks, be in our hearts and our minds as we move forward toward heaven in faith. We ask these things, Lord, in the worthy name of Jesus. And for his sake, we pray. Let all God's people together say in one voice, amen.
Amen. At this time, we want to invite our students from Peterson to come and to share with us again.
As the students quickly come forward, I just wanted to let you know that we are very happy that they were all here, and I just want to let them know that they've done a fantastic job. I am so proud of them. Not yet. You guys move on. I also want to let the church know that we have made a GoFundMe page to help with our school budget. If you go to the Peterson-Warren.net website, there is a link. We would be more than happy to have a donation. Every little bit helps. And we are just looking forward to all the support. But I want to thank you for those who came out to our Taste Fest. Because of your generosity in coming out and supporting us, we made over $1,000 toward our trip to the Creation Museum in Noah's Ark. And we're going there because we want to make the Bible real for our students, not just words on a paper. We want them to have other experiences. And thank you. And we look forward to you coming and joining us tomorrow for our science and reading fair, so you can see some of the academics that have been going on. Thank you so much. So what we're going to do now is we have a young lady who would like to share with you, and then our high school will do a recitation on wisdom, and then Elder Perry will, she wrote a poem for us. And then finally, the elementary will present a poem entitled, To Be Educated.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
My name is Aria Mitchell, and I am a seventh grader at Peterson Warren Academy. Peterson Warren Academy has had a spiritual effect on my life after I left public schools. I've been at Peterson Warren Academy since second grade all the way to seventh. The students at Peterson don't want nothing to happen to the school as much as I do. I don't. So I pray, church, that you come to Peterson tomorrow to see how our science fair reading fair goes and see if you think about sending your students here to help us and so they could have a spiritual effect on their life also.
Amen.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath.
Good afternoon. Some of our students are not here, so I will be taking their place. Now, I just want you all to know, being the teacher that I am, I had the students memorize their part. What do I have? Paper. Good example, aren't I? Okay. Wisdom, scriptural base, Proverbs 2 and 3.
What is wisdom?
How can I be really smart?
Is it something I can buy or
hard to learn?
That wise old king was smart.
And Paul was real smart.
What is wisdom?
Apply your heart to understanding.
And if you call out for insight.
And cry aloud for understanding.
And look for it as for silver.
And search for it as for hidden treasure.
Like gold and pearls and money?
It is a treasure.
If you really search
passionately,
then you will find the knowledge of God.
For the Lord gives wisdom.
If
you turn your ear
and apply your heart
and call out for insight
and cry aloud for understanding
and look in search.
I think I'm pretty smart.
I've gone to school for a long time.
Maybe I have to give all my smarts to Jesus.
And you can take all those smarties and coat them with pretty colors.
And then we'll be happy.
Happy is the man,
woman,
teen or child.
Happy is the person who discovers wisdom,
the one who gains discernment.
Can I buy it?
She is beyond the price of pearls.
She is more precious than rubies.
You cannot buy it.
But you may have it.
It is a gift.
A gift?
A gift.
The Lord gives us wisdom when we
trust in the Lord.
All our heart.
And
lean not on our own understanding. He will direct our paths.
And we will have wisdom
through him.
Amen.
Good morning, church. Why we need Peterson Warren Academy. Try looking at Peterson through the eyes of God and see the potential being rediscovered. For Peterson is a school that God still embraces and he still cherishes and mothers. Peterson is a school that years ago, it was chosen as God's chosen jewel. And it's been proven that when we cooperate with God, he supplies Peterson with every God-given tool. God has blessed the foundation of Peterson. Veteran principals and teachers tell the story. Many years, Peterson's halls thrive with students, and today we can bring back that glory. The teachers, principal, and treasurer go the extra mile, working long, tiring hours each day. They do it because for them it's a ministry. And definitely not just for the pay. We all want Peterson doors to remain open, and working our prayers and faith is the key. It's not just because Peterson is the only K-12 school in the conference of LRC. It's because parents and constituents are one family, and although the enrollment is small, you can still hear the name of our lovely Jesus ringing down those Peterson halls. It's because when the students make friends, their bond goes beyond every strife. They graduate, go to college, and even then, they become friends for life. Students need more than just earthly pursuits. They're pursuing a heavenly, eternal lot. It's better to place your child where God is praised than in an institution where he is not. The Lord is not saying ignore Peterson's needs. He wants his school to lead out and be grand. He gives gifts, talents, time, and money to develop through him a quality plan. You may say, there's other Christian SDA schools where truth is pure and can still impart, but why not band together and help build up the school that's closest to our heart? Now, if we close our ears to unprofitable memories that keep us wallowing in the past, we realize that it's a brand new day, and what we do from now on will hold fast. The conference, constituents, and parents must aggressively work in unity. We must help shine Peterson's light on a hill all throughout the Inkster community. Have you thought about what you can do? Transportation, send funds, sponsor a child. Just imagine what God can do with our school when all of our gifts together are compiled. We thank God for the staff, volunteers, and constituents. We take note of all that they do. And we thank parents for putting their children in your hands. Peterson stands because of you. And when Jesus walks the Peterson halls, entering every classroom you see, we want him to stop, pause, and smile and say, "This is where I want my children to be."
It's time for our children's story, so we're going to ask our children to please come down front after the pastor.
I'm sorry, right before our children's story, I just want to say something about what we just heard. I don't want us to be distracted, so I'm going to give everybody an opportunity to settle down before I speak. We're going to ask our ushers if you would take this time to be ready with the papers that we gave you. Don't hand them out yet, but if you can have them ready to hand out, that would be good. Now, what we just heard from our students was very powerful. It could have been the sermon all by itself, because the Word of God says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. That's a statement about Christian education. As a matter of fact, it's a statement just about education. There really is only one education. There's education, and then there's false education. That's what the whole Word of God is meant to teach us. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, and of wisdom, rather, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. In other words, when we have proper education, it always begins in the context of God who made everything. And as we learned in the context of submission and faith to God, then every single subject that we pursue, in that subject, we gain insight about the creation, about ourselves, and about the Creator, his heart, his will, his way. And that leads us to further submission and further wisdom and praise. That's education. That's education. When students learn this way in this context, then they excel in this life for God's glory, and they move on to higher learning in the world to come. That's why we have our schools. We call it the Daniel difference. It doesn't mean that you have to make a distinction between academic excellence and spiritual excellence. No. True education is always both. Did you hear me? If we pursue education the way that God intended for us to pursue it in Christ, it would always lead to academic excellence, physical excellence, mental excellence, and spiritual excellence as well. That's what happened to Daniel and his friends. They were able to go to Babylon, and because they pursued the knowledge of the Lord above everything, they were able to excel at Babylonian education, and when the king reviewed them, they were 10 times better physically, mentally, or academically. And what the king didn't know, they were 10 times better spiritually as well. That's why we have our schools. There's education, and then there's false education. Now, it may sound like I'm being hard when I say that, but I'm not being hard. That's the gospel truth. Everything else is meant to separate the pursuit of knowledge from the pursuit of the Creator. And we might think, well, I'm going to let them have a pagan education that separates learning from God, and then I'm going to supplement it. But we don't understand that education is the communication of worldview. So every school is trying to not only tell you what's academic, they're trying to tell you what reality is. They're trying to tell you who you are. And while one message is being conveyed in one setting, and we're trying to combat that message at home, we don't realize that it's like trying to keep your garden
without getting any weeds. The weeds are growing faster than the good fruit. Do you see it? A worldview is being communicated. It's a worldview of life independent of God. In other words, he doesn't even exist. We didn't get here because of him. And you owe nothing to him. There's not going to be a judgment. And you can be whatever you want to be and do whatever you want to do independent of God. It's communicating world view. Not only about self-identity, but also about sexual orientation, origins, purpose, and the destiny of man. There's only one education. There's only one. Now, as a lifelong Seventh-day Adventist educated person, from the beginning to my master's degree, I can stand here and tell you that Christian education can be effective. But I can also tell you that it can also be, in some ways, very defective, and it can cause us to lose what we should have because we do not always center what we're doing on Christ. We have not always reached the ideal that God has set out for us. And those are the places where we see failure. And we have to admit that. We have to acknowledge that. We have to repent so that that can be changed. But that doesn't mean that we should abandon what Christ has given us. This is not the time to retreat. This is not the time to abandon it. This is the time for us to rally together. This is the time for us to submit our hearts to the Lord. This is the time for us to bring our gifts, our insights, our resources, and bring it to the table to say, let us do all that we can right now to make our school what Christ has envisioned for it to be. That means we need you. We need you. Let me say it again. We need you. We need your prayers. We need your efforts. We need your students. We need your funds. We need your insight, your gifts, your ability. Some of you out there know exactly what needs to be done. Well, don't wait to see it happen. Come and help us do it. This is our golden God-given opportunity to make our school all that it should be in Jesus' name. Let's respond to that. Now listen, what I've just said is hard. It's hard. And for some, it may even be offensive. I don't intend to offend you, but I do intend to tell you the truth as it is in Jesus. Because judgment is coming. And the eternal destiny of our children is at stake. So today, I want to invite you to respond. We've seen beautiful things. We've heard wonderful things. Now we need to respond. I want to invite us to our ushers to pass out those sheets we have. We have a flyer. We also have a sheet that says intent to register. Let's quickly put a flyer and the sheet for intent to register in everyone's hand. Let's do that as fast as we possibly can. We have folks in the balcony. Let's send some up to the balcony also. If we need help, let's get help so that we can do this as quickly as possible. Now, there's one there about the revival. That's separate.
but for the school and for the intent to register. That's what we want in everybody's hand right now. School and intent to register. Fly for the school and the intent to register. Let's put that in everyone's hand, please. Okay. Now you've heard that in order for our school to maintain its status as a kindergarten to 12th grade institution, that by the end of April, we need to show the intent to register for at least 70 students, or we need to raise a little over $100,000, or a combination of the two. Right? So either we need to show an intent to register for at least 70 students, raise a little more than $100,000, or we need to do some combination of the two. What I'd like to ask you to do is I'd like for you, if you have a child, to register or to sign up your intent to register that child for the next school year. Even if you already have your child at the school, we just want to know that you intend to register your child next year. If you don't, and you don't even know how it's going to be possible, but you want to respond to this appeal and you want your child to go, just write your intent to register. And we're going to see how the Lord is going to work out the rest, but we want you to say, I would like for my child to go. Now, maybe you have a grandchild, a niece, a nephew, a neighbor, another family member who you would like to see go, and you would like to make an appeal to that child's parent in order for them to attend. Maybe you can take this opportunity to sign up or intend to write an intent to register for them as well. The first thing we need is students. The next thing that we need, though, are funds. We also need funds. Now, this morning, somebody walked up to me and they gave me a money order in the amount of $5,000 for the school. This person told me that they walk 6 miles because their transportation is out. They walk 6 miles to the bank to get this money order in order to bring the funds because they want to see our school succeed. Now, that's nothing more than the Spirit of God impressing the heart of that person. $5,000 from one person? Right? I believe this is a sacrifice. This represents a sacrifice. Now, I believe that we should respond in kind. Right? If one person can give that, then what can the entire church do? We need to respond in kind. And so today, what I would like to do is I would like to challenge us to respond to the conviction of the Holy Spirit to sacrificially give for the sake of our school. I would like to see us at least quadruple the value of this check today. In other words, between now and June 1st, I would like us to pledge what we're going to give in order to respond to this appeal right now. What I would like for at least 5 of us privately right there to write on that white sheet that you have, to write your name and to write your pledge. I would like at least 5 of us to pledge $1,000 between now, the monies will be turned in between now and June 1st. At least 5 individuals to say, I'm going to do that. Really, before I say that, I should say, maybe there's somebody that would like to match the $5,000. Right? And it will be a sacrifice for you too, but you're going to take the challenge. Maybe there's someone that would do that or more. But at least 5 individuals to say, I'm going to pledge $1,000 between now and June 1st. If you would write that down, what we're going to do is we're going to collect these pledges
and we're going to tally up so that by the end of service, we can tell you what we have. Then we would like to have 10 individuals, at least 10 individuals, who will pledge $500 between now and June 1st. Right? We're doing this by conviction and faith. The Spirit is moving on your heart. If you feel that conviction, don't fight with it. Step out on faith and do it. $500 between now and June 1st. And then I would like to have at least 20 individuals to pledge $250 between now and June 1st. Right? So maybe you want to match it. Maybe you want to match it or more. Maybe you want to be one of the five to give $1,000. Maybe you want to be one of the 10 to pledge $500. Maybe you want to be one of the 20 to pledge $250. Today, I'm going to make my pledge in faith. It's going to be a sacrifice. But I'm going to make that pledge in faith, and I'm going to watch the Lord make that pledge come to fruition. Do you believe it today? I want to invite you to join me. If we do this, at least we'll be able to make this $5,000 $20,000 if we do what we just said, $20,000. I just heard 2 days ago about a church that heard of this, a small church that hardly has it, that pledged $10,000 to the school. Right? Now, that's a small church. Now, what can we do? What can we do? We ought to be able to do something in the name of Jesus. We need to respond. Will you join me in that? Amen. So please write down your pledge. We're going to ask our ushers to come to the front and then move to the back. And as you move to the back, we're going to collect your sheet, and then we're going to take those sheets up to the treasury room. They're ready to tally the pledges to let us know what it is that has been pledged today. Between now and June 1st, we're pledging what we're going to do. So we're going to ask our ushers to come to the front, and then they will collect on the way to the back. Okay, someone just texted me a pledge for $500. They're not here. They're out of town watching online. Amen? Praise God for that. Praise God for that. Maybe there's somebody else that's watching online right now, and the Spirit of God is moving on your heart to make a pledge. We want to invite you to respond to the conviction of the Spirit of God, and God is going to help you to honor your pledge. Okay, as soon as you're ready, would you pass in your sheet? Pass in your sheets now to the ushers so that we'll be able to collect them. Okay, in the comment section on the sheet, write down in the comment section, you can write what your pledge is. Please put your name and your pledge so that we can know how to follow up with you. Give us information to be able to follow up with you. I'm filling out mine right now. Yes, just watch. We need a little time? Okay, well, let's take the time. I know church has gone a little bit longer than usual, but we're going to be flexible today. Is that all right? Sometimes we need to be flexible. Amen. Just got another text, another person out of town, $1,000 pledged. Amen? Praise God. Text them back.
Okay, another text. $250 pledge. Another pledge, $1,000 pledge. Now, somebody's worried because right now we've got a capital campaign going on here at City Temple, right? Somebody's saying, what's going to happen to our capital campaign? Because we're trying to get all of our kids to Camperee. I can't give for this, give for offering, and give to that too. Oh, no, yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can do it all by the grace of Jesus Christ. He's going to make it possible for us to do everything that needs to be done. We have it. Just got another pledge. Somebody else that's not here. $3,000 pledge. Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Okay. Raise your hand if you still need time, or if you have a sheet that still needs to come in. Raise your hand so we can see where we are. Okay, so we're pledging now so that we'll have cash in hand by June 1st. June 1st is the deadline. Amen. Isn't God good? I want to pray over this. We have folks that are waving their sheets in the balcony. Let's go to the balcony to get that, please. Here they come. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you so much. Your spirit has moved on our hearts, and we've responded. Lord, we thank you for giving us the gift of Adventist Christian education. We thank you for your son, Jesus, who alone makes true education possible. Today, Lord, we want to step out by faith in his name to surrender to him, to yield our hearts and our families to him. And Lord, we thank you for your spirit that has touched our hearts because we're even giving our resources. Now, Lord, I'm asking that you would honor these vows and that you would give us grace to honor them. Lord, we pray that you would send the funds so that we can send them to you. Lord, we ask that we would not only be successful in this endeavor, but also all of the other things, Lord, that you know desperately need to be done. We ask, O Lord, that you'll give us a heart and a mind to rally together, to unify together as one in your son's name to get it done. In Jesus' name, let all God's children say, amen. Amen. Somebody just texted me and said, I'm still giving $500 for the capital campaign. Another person texted me with another pledge for $1,000. This is another person that's out of town. Praise God. Amen. Let's move on with our worship service. We're going to streamline to our song right before our message. Then we're going to have our message. And I'm not going to preach long today, everybody. You time me, okay? All right. God bless.
In the spirit of being thankful, we just want to say, Lord, you are good. We owe you so much, God. It's a real simple worship. It says,
Lord, you are good. You've been so good. Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life, can't praise you enough, even if I try, cause you've been so good, you've been so good, you've been so good to me.
are good. You've been so good.
Say, Lord, you are.
Lord, you are good.
You've been better.
You've been better than
I can praise you.
I can praise you.
I owe you my life.
I owe you my life.
You
can't praise you
enough. Even if I try.
Even if I try, cause
you've been so good to me. Oh Lord, Lord, you are, you've been so good. Lord, you
are good.
You've been better.
You've been better than good.
And I can't praise you. I owe you my life. I can't praise you, even if I try.
Even if I try,
you've been so good. To me, oh Lord,
you are good.
You've been so good,
so good.
And we thank you, Jesus.
Lord, you are good.
You've been better.
You've been better than good.
And I can't
praise you enough.
I owe you my life.
I owe you my life. Can't praise you enough.
Even if I try. So good,
so good
to you be.
So good.
You've been
so
good,
so good
to me. Come on, if I could just see somebody's hands lifting in worship. See so many doors,
so many doors you opened,
so many ways you made,
so many ways you made,
so many times you healed me. Is that your testimony this morning? Somebody say that.
So many doors you opened,
in so many ways,
so many
times. Guess what? You've been better than good to me. See so many
doors. So many ways.
So many times. You've been better than good to me. See so many
doors.
God, you made a way out of no way. So many times. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good. You've been better than good to me. Yeah. You've been better than good to me. 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 One more time, everybody. You've been better than good to me.
You've
better than good to me.
And you've
been better than good to me. Because you've been so good. Can you say that? You've been so good.
So good.
You've been so good.
So good.
You've been so, so good. You've
been
so good.
So good.
To me. Come on now, somebody give God the praise that he's due. Because he's been better than good. I can't repay you enough for all you've done for me. I can't repay you enough for everything you've been in my life. I can't repay you enough. Even when I wasn't good myself, Lord, I couldn't repay you enough for all you've done. Cause you've been so good. Come on, sing that. You've been. I need to hear everybody's voice. So good. Lift up the worship. You've been. Lift up the standard of worship. And talk about the goodness of Jesus. And all he's done for you.
See you be so good to me.
Come on, let's seal our declaration with the praise this morning. Hallelujah.
Good afternoon, City. My name is Miles Crawford, and I am a proud student at Peterson Warren Academy, and I will be reading the scripture for today's service. If you have it, please turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians 5:18, and please stand. If you have it, please stand with me, and we will read together. Does everybody have it? Okay. It says, and be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. So what this means to me is do not be filled with Satan's temptations, but be filled with the Spirit of the Lord, for he will help you on your right path. May the Lord add a rich blessing to the reading, hearing, and application of his word. You may be seated.
I want to praise God for the ministry of our students and also for the ministry of music today, which was a blessing. Praise God. Let's pray and go right into the word. Father in heaven, we ask in Jesus' name that you would give us grace now, open our eyes, that we may receive what you have for us. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. I read about an old Scottish woman who was extremely poor. Where she lived, actually, she had a dirt floor inside of her tiny little house. She had a wood stove, and she really was struggling. She had one son that she raised, and years before, when he became an adult, he went away to study in the United States. He came here to the U.S. and became very successful and actually became very wealthy. But there she was, still living in squalor. It's a very terrible situation. She had a friend in the village who knew her for many years and knew her son that happening to be visiting with her one day, looking around at just how terrible things were for her. And she was wanting to be delicate, but at the same time, she was wondering, why hasn't her son helped her to change her situation? And so she asked her at a certain point in the conversation, she said, do you ever hear from your son? And the old woman said, oh, yes, yes, I hear from him all the time. He sends me letters and he tells me what's going on with him in the United States. And she said, he also sends me these strange pictures. The friend said, really? Do you mind if I see some of these pictures? And there it was, the woman went and got a box, an old tattered box, and inside she had envelopes with letters, and she was pulling out of the envelopes just all of these banknotes, with pictures, yes, but also valuing thousands and thousands of dollars. There she was, very rich, but living in poverty, because she did not know what she had already
received.
Many Christians desire to live a more full and more powerful Christian experience, but because of misunderstanding and in some cases lack of instruction, spiritually we live in poverty, even though the truth is that we are already rich. Today we're going to be talking about how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. It's the beginning of our series on the Holy Spirit and revival that we'll be doing this entire week. On tomorrow night, Sunday night, and Monday night, we're going to be dealing with the topic, When the Spirit Comes, Part 1 and Part 2. We're going to be talking about the meaning of the resurrection. We're going to be talking about common misunderstandings and false teachings related to the Holy Spirit and the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We're going to be talking about the purpose and use of charismatic gifts. We're going to deal with the gifts of the Spirit. We're going to talk about being slain in the Spirit, receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk about speaking in tongues. We're going to deal with all of that Sunday night and Monday night. Then Wednesday night, we're going to be at Conan. And then on Friday night, we're going to be dealing with the topic, how to know God's will through the Holy Spirit. So you don't want to miss this week. But today, our focus is on being filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1. I'm going to read in your hearing verses 12 and 13. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. I'm reading this morning from the English Standard Version, Ephesians 1, and beginning with verse 12. It says, "So that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the Spirit of promise." Did you hear verse 13? It says, "In him also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit." In order to be filled with the Holy Spirit, we must first receive the Holy Spirit. So therefore, we need to understand what it takes in order to receive the Holy Spirit in the first place. Paul explains to the Ephesian believers that they received the Holy Spirit when they believed the message about Jesus. How does someone receive the Holy Spirit? You first receive the Holy Spirit when you believe the message about Jesus. In John chapter 1, verses 12, 11 and 12, John says, "He came unto his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, even to them that believed on his name, to them he gave power to become the children of God." Do you hear that? When they received him, when they believed on his name, that's when they received power or the right to become children of God. John's going to later explain that that is by receiving the Holy Spirit. Again, in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 2, Paul says to the Galatian believers, he says, "Tell me this, did you receive the Holy Spirit by works of the law, or did you receive the Holy Spirit by hearing and faith?" Do you hear that? In order to receive the Holy Spirit, the way we get it in the very first place is by hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ preached or taught. And when we believe in Jesus after hearing that message, the result of that belief is that we receive the Holy Spirit. Have you had this fundamental experience of hearing, believing, and receiving the Holy Spirit? Have you received the Holy Spirit? If not, you can receive the Holy Spirit today. I remember reading a story, a true story, of something that happened to Billy Graham. There was an evangelistic meeting going on in Halifax, Nova Scotia, and it was going on for quite some time, but one night Billy Graham was going to be the guest evangelist. But unbeknownst to the crowd, Billy Graham came in one day early. He put on a baseball cap and some shades and went and sat down in the audience to listen to the gospel preach. Well, one of the local preachers that was there was preaching that night, and Billy Graham happened to be sitting behind an older gentleman who he noticed was listening to the message intently. You could tell he was very interested, hanging on every word. And when the preacher made the call in order for people to come and accept Jesus Christ, he noticed that the man didn't move. He expected he would. So Billy Graham leaned forward, tapped him on the shoulder, and said, "Would you like to receive Christ today? I can walk down with you if you'd like." The man hesitated for a moment, not realizing he was speaking to Billy Graham, who he was waiting for the next night. He turned and said, "Nah, I'll think I'll wait till tomorrow night when the big gun comes." Many of us are just like that man. Our opportunity to receive what God has for us through his Spirit has already come. In fact, even now, it's already here. However, because we expect a big gun experience, we don't respond in the way that we should, because we're looking for something that's going to be outwardly impressive, demonstrative. We're looking for something that maybe will even be emotional, something that will be stirring, something that we'll be able to say, "This is what happened. This is where I was." And right now, as the gospel is preached, you have an opportunity to receive the Spirit by simple faith. Have you received the Spirit? Paul goes on in Ephesians 5 and verse 18. Now our main text, he says in Ephesians 5, 18, "And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery." In other words, reckless, uncontrollable living. He says, "But be filled with the Spirit." Do you hear that? First, he begins by saying that you receive the Spirit when you first believe. Everyone who received the gospel and believed, put their trust in Christ, has the Spirit. But now the apostle commands every believer, it's an apostolic command, meaning it's a command from Christ, that every believer should be filled with the Spirit. Be filled. You have it, but you're not automatically going to be filled with it. Now you must be filled with the Spirit. We don't see it in our English version, but in the original language, the present active tense is really saying continuously. Keep on. Over and over again. Keep on being filled with the Spirit, and then get filled again, and then get filled again. Be filled with the Spirit over and over and over. The infilling of the Holy Spirit is not once and for all. It is something that every believer must seek to experience every single day. We should be daily looking for the infilling or the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In John 20, verse 22, I'm not going to turn there for the time. John 20, verse 22, Jesus shows up to the disciples in the upper room and he breathes on them and says, "Receive the Holy Ghost." He gave them the Holy Ghost before Pentecost. Did you know that? And then in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, it says that the Spirit comes in like a mighty rushing wind, and cloven tongues of fire was over every person's head, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And in one day, 3,000 people were baptized at the preaching of the message of the Apostle Peter. But then again in Acts chapter 4 and verse 31, after Peter and John have just come from bearing their testimony to the Sanhedrin, they come to the believers and they share what happened, and they realize that the enemy is coming against the work of the gospel. And so they start to pray. They call on the name of God and they ask God to stretch forth his hand and to move through his Son. And it says, once again, the place was shaken and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And many people came to faith again, 5,000 this time. Do you see that? The infilling of the Holy Spirit is not once and for all. It's something that individually as believers, and collectively as the church, we should be experiencing as an ongoing, normal experience. One of the reasons why we're not, this is not in my notes, but because we have become afraid of the Holy Spirit, because of the false teachings that are out there about the Holy Spirit. That's why tomorrow night and Monday night, we're going to be dealing with those false teachings. So we should know what we should expect of the Spirit when the Spirit comes. But this should be our ongoing experience of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Do you know, or do you experience, or are you walking in the daily infilling of the Holy Spirit? I remember reading about Dwight Moody, who was visiting. He was a guest evangelist in another country, and he had been preaching, and people were talking about how this man was so full of the Holy Spirit that when he preached, how it brought conviction to hearts, and people were convicted of their sin, and they responded. And two little girls followed him one night after the meeting. They wanted to know, well, how is this man? What makes him so special? Why is he so full of the Holy Spirit? They followed him, and they saw him go all the way to where he was staying. He went in the room. He didn't know, but there they were, and they were looking through the little keyhole. And when they looked in the keyhole, you know what they saw? This is not advisable, by the way, but what, you know what they saw? They saw the man of God get down on his knees, and he started praying. Then he stretched out and laid prostrate on the ground. And you know what he said? After a while, they saw him writhing, and they heard him yell out, "Lord, hold your power." He was so filled with the Holy Ghost. He was saying, "Lord, I don't know what to do with all of this." And he experienced that over and over and over again. And that should not be unusual. That should be the experience of every believer being filled with the Holy Spirit over and over again. Do you know what happens if that's not our experience? The alternative to being filled with the Spirit is carnal Christianity. Do you know what carnal Christianity is? I want to read for you now, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. This is what it says. "But brothers, I could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh." Here, the King James says, "but as carnal, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now you are not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way?" Do you see how Paul contrasts two ways of living as a Christian? Either you're spiritual or you're carnal, right? Carnal is from the Latin carne. You know what that means? Meat, flesh, right? You're carnal. Either you're of the flesh or you're of the Spirit, meaning that either the Spirit characterizes your life or the flesh characterizes your life. A spiritual life is full of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Such a person is led by the Spirit of Christ, and his or her life is marked by the fruit of the Spirit, marked by self-sacrifice, and marked by humility. A carnal person has received the Spirit of Christ, yet continues to be led by the flesh. Do you see that? So an unbeliever has never received the Spirit of Christ. That's just a worldly unbeliever. That person's spirit has never been made alive. A believer receives the Spirit of Christ, but either you receive it and then still live according to the flesh, which is called carnality, or you receive the Spirit and you fulfill the command that Paul just gave, and you become filled with the Spirit over and over again until that characterizes your life. A carnal person's life is marked by self-centeredness and self-will. Such a person, like the Corinthians, is still ruled by a worldly way of thinking and still seeking worldly pleasures, worldly ambitions, worldly satisfaction. Such people form church communities that are marked by jealousy, strife, and division. When you have a church full of people who receive the Spirit because they believe, but they're not in the habit of being filled with the Spirit, then it becomes a carnal community. And you can see that because there will always be strife and jealousy, self-seeking. A carnal person is still controlled by the impulses or cravings of his body, his emotions, his will, and his thoughts. Are you a carnal person? Or are you a spiritual person? The only way to be spiritual is to surrender your life to the life of Christ, to be filled with the life of Christ every single day. Last night, I had a dream, and in a portion of the dream, I was led into a church. And it was a very strange church. It was not this church, but it was a big sanctuary, and you could see down front that church was going on, and the preacher was getting ready to come up to the pulpit. But as I walked in, the first thing I noticed is that most of the chairs in the church were facing backwards away from the pulpit. Some of the chairs, just a few of them, were facing the pulpit, but there were hardly any people sitting in those chairs. Most of the people were sitting facing away from the pulpit. The person who led me in led me over to sit in one of the chairs that was facing away from the pulpit. And I said, well, wait a minute. How am I supposed to be able to see what's going on when I'm faced away from the pulpit? The person pointed, the person next to me pointed to a monitor in the back. So you could look at the monitor and see what was going on down front. I woke up, I said, Lord, what does that dream mean? And you know what I was impressed with? That many believers are living their Christian life just that way right now. A secondary experience, an indirect experience. Many believers are coming to church, but it is as though their backs are turned to the Word of God. Their hearts are not in it. Their lives are not being transformed. They're there as spectators, but they're not really there to be moved and transformed by the Word of Christ and the Spirit of Christ. They're carnal Christians. I don't want to be a carnal Christian. You know what happens to a carnal believer? After a while, that person is hardened by the deceitfulness of sin, and they go right back out into the world or right back out into judgment. In other words, what I mean by in the world is it's not necessarily physically back out into the world. You can stay in the church in that condition for years, but you have come back under the judgment of God. And when Christ comes, you won't be saved, even though you once received the Spirit. Don't think that you received the Spirit and then that's it. That's a false teaching. You're not once saved, always saved. You receive the Spirit, and then you have to be filled with the Spirit until he pervades your entire life so that the old temple is filled with the presence of God. It shines out of your face and out of your eyes. It's seen in your life and in your love and in your self-sacrifice. If that doesn't happen, that's why the apostles, like Paul, keep saying to them, don't be deceived. The ungodly will not inherit the kingdom of God. Against these such things is the judgment of God coming against the ungodly. In other words, don't think that you're secure because you're in church. You better allow Christ to fill your entire life, or you come right back under the judgment of God. I want to give anyone here today who has not received the Holy Spirit or is not sure whether you have the opportunity to receive the Holy Spirit right now. The promise is that the one who hears the gospel and responds in faith will receive the Holy Spirit. As many as received him, to them he gave power to become the children of God, even to them that believed on his name. So what's the gospel? Let me tell you very quickly. The gospel is that this world is doomed to destruction because of man's rebellion against God. This judgment can be seen in nature by natural disasters such as cataclysmic earthquakes and tsunamis and tornadoes and hurricanes, climate change and confusion of seasons. We see it in nature. We also see it in society. We see it in the increasing wickedness and hardness and self-centeredness of people in the world all around us. It's not an accident that narcissism is the catchphrase of our day and what we see played out before us, because that's what's happening in the hearts of wicked men. I watched a video. I didn't know what it was. Somebody sent me. I started watching it. It was the video of the man who brutally killed the people in New Zealand while they were worshiping. I saw the video. He was just going. He was just killing people like they were nothing. And he was videotaping it and streaming it live. He was killing people like he was in a video game. You could tell his conscience was completely gone, seared with a hot iron. And we're going to see more and more and more of this, because the judgment of God, the coming judgment of God, can be seen in the wickedness of men and women, in boys and girls in society right now. We're seeing even the seeming stability of government crumbling right before our eyes. We also see the impending judgment of God in our own hearts. In our consciences, we must acknowledge that selfishness is there and longs to have the mastery. There are wicked thoughts and desires, the desire to live according to our own selves, to have nobody at all tell us what to do. We want to throw off and rebel against all forms of authority, even God himself. It's revealed in our hearts. The judgment of God is coming, and there's nothing at all that we can do to save ourselves, even at our very best. Our hearts are bent towards evil. The desire to live our own way, to live in our own thinking and will, to live according to the desires and impulses of our flesh. We are leading ourselves to self-destruction. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof is death. So we need a Savior. There's only one Savior, God's appointed Son, Jesus Christ. God has set him to be the one to deliver us from our sins and to save us from his coming judgment and to reunite us to him in a life of love and submission and obedience to him as the Lord and creator of our lives. God has put his seal of approval on his Son, his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, by raising him from the dead. This Jesus is the stone which you builders rejected that has become the cornerstone, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And today, he will save you. Today, he will forgive you. Today, he will give you new life through the gift of his Holy Spirit. if only you would say yes. One yes. Just reaching out by faith and saying yes to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he saves you and gives you his Spirit today. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord, the same shall be saved. Do you want to receive that life today? Do you want to receive the Holy Spirit today? Well, if that's you, I just want you to raise your hand. You want that life? You want that Spirit? Just raise your hand where you are. Praise God. Praise God. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the promise and the gift of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we raise our hands today to receive it by faith. So fulfill your promise, Lord. Come into our hearts and bring new life. Lord, I pray today especially for the person who does not know you and has not given themselves to you. I ask, Lord, today that for that person, you would perform the miracle of making their heart new. Sprinkle their consciences with water, Lord. Wash them in the blood. Make them clean. Give them a heart of flesh and take away the heart of stone. Lord, give them a new spirit and then come and put your Spirit inside of them. Lord, today I pray that someone under the sound of my voice is receiving Jesus and his life through his Spirit today. Thank you, Lord, for that promise. And for the rest of us, Lord, who have received your Spirit before, we're asking, Lord, for an infilling of your Spirit right now. Cleanse us from sin and self and selfishness. And Lord, we surrender to you in faith. We ask that the life of Christ would fill us. May we not be in control of our own selves anymore. But Lord, we want you to be in control. You take charge and do with us as you will. Lead us, Father, and guide us for your will, your way, and for your glory. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. And not just today, Lord, but tomorrow, the day after, and every day. Lord, we ask that you'd bring us out on tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. We're going to learn what to look for and expect when the Spirit comes. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in our hearts. And we yield to it in Jesus' name. Let all God's children say, amen. If you've made a new commitment to give Jesus your heart today, please let me know. Let me know, because I'd like to talk with you and support you. This time, we're going to have our benediction, and Elder Nettie Gray will come. Hold on a moment. Okay, go ahead.
Before Sister Wilson comes to give our benediction, ladies, we're asking that you'll meet us beneath the balcony for a brief session of testimony and prayer. We have been praying over our calendars, praying for the names, so we would like to hear your testimonies and then have a season of prayer immediately following the service. Thank you.
Now let us go in faith, being filled with the life of Christ, as he has promised to give us. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory in great joy, to the only God,
our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.